I love presenting after circles because I can skip so many slides because circles works similar, not the same, to Trustlines. My name is Andreas. I work at Brainbot. I have been working together with the team on Trustlines for 4 years, and we have learned a lot. So I'm going to talk a little bit about how Trustlines works and more about what we've learned during the period. I'm going to start the presentation by asking, who in this room loves money? Awesome. I love money. I think money is the best product that there is because you can do everything with money. The problem is only banks can create money or states can create money. Question mark. So we introduce the concept of people-powered money, where basically every person on the world is able to create their own money with the people that they trust, so that they can exchange with those people and be part of the financial system without relying on traditional finance. We didn't invent it. The old concept, mutual credit, the traditional financial system works very similar to it. A lot of other projects use very similar concepts. What we basically just did, we used mutual credit, we used blockchain, we rumbled it up together in one and built basically infrastructure that is censorship resistant, that cannot be shut down by governments, so that we can go into different countries where there are corrupt governments and basically, people are able to use it without the fear of presidents or dictators coming and saying, well, you have to shut it down. And they can still say it's illegal, but they cannot shut it down because we're using blockchain. Quick recap of how Trustlines works. Basically, you need two people. That's the minimum set of people that you need. You need Alice, you need Bob. They can be named different, but you always need at least two. They create a credit line with each other. Basically, a trust lines, two credit lines. How much will I be able to spend with you? How much will you be able to spend with me? And what they then issue between each other are IOUs. So that if, for example, Alice wants to buy something from Bob, they don't need money, they just need IOUs that are represented on the chain itself. And Alice can buy something from Bob. Alice issues 5 IOUs in, for example, dollar, and Bob receives the IOUs, and he has basically $5 more, and Alice can buy an apple from him. It works good with people that you know. It doesn't work too good with people that you don't know, because I would not lend money to a stranger. But that's where basically, and Julio already mentioned it, the trust graphs and the 6 paths of separation works. We know enough people on the world to reach the people that we want to exchange goods and services with. So if you basically have Charlie here, and Alice wants to buy something from Charlie, but Alice does not know Charlie, and Charlie does not know Alice, it's not a problem because both of them know Bob, and they can basically jump over Bob and still be able to exchange goods and services. And this works basically up to a lot of different people, up to having a new person, for example, Dave. And one of the core components of our system itself is that credit in the system always aims to balance down. So every payment that is triggered in the system always looks for, is there a path of connected people that will reduce the total imbalance of the system? So it's netting, basically, out of like traditional finance, always trying to net and clear, reduce the overall debt in the system. And if it doesn't find a path that basically reduces the overall debt, it'll just take the shortest one. And then also maybe in regards to the Sybil attack discussion that was just with circles, etc. Yes, Eve could create a lot of different accounts and have huge, trust lines with herself, but at the end, it's always bottlenecked by one person that basically shields the whole network from Sybil attacks. And you could scale that up to Eve having 1 billion accounts, it wouldn't matter. So the question is this money? And as I did say, I think money is the best product. Answering this question is really, really hard, because at the end, money is something that is either defined by people that created themselves or something that is needed by people to conduct payments with each other. And now I'm going to go a little bit in the experience that we had over the past 4 years and why systems like trust lines or circles are really hard to implement in societies, because people don't know what money is. People don't understand what money is. And if I say people, I'm referring to the majority of the people. People in crypto, I would argue, have a better understanding of money than the average person who lives every day in, you know, Germany, has a bank account, knows that they have money on their bank account, goes to Rewe, buys bread, apples, etc. If you explain them what money is, the majority of the people don't understand it. And Trustlines itself is more like a project that we're trying to go into countries where they don't have traditional payment systems, because we believe that those are the countries that we can empower to have basically their own financial system. And they have totally different problems that are unrelated to the lack of money. We have one project, or we had one project in Venezuela, and Venezuela was one of the best fits that we had had ever. So Venezuela, they have a huge problem with their local currency. It's worth nothing. They use US dollars to do payments. And we said, that's awesome, because we have, you know, more than 30 different currencies in the Trustlines app. They can use Trustlines and they can use US dollars. And we had three people on the ground talking to locals, talking to businesses, and going into deeper of how they use the dollars. We got more and more hype that, you know, Trustlines could be a good fit, because the problem that they have with dollars is they have only big dollar bills. So they have 20s, they have 50s, they have hundreds. And if they go into a shop and they buy something for like $6, the shop is not able to give them change that is small. So what do? They use a piece of paper and they say, I owe you $14. And we're like, this is Trustlines, this is awesome. Just use the app. Huh? We like did meetups there, we onboarded bar, bakery, etc. And one of the biggest problems was they don't want to pay with their phone. They're scared to get, you know, take their phone out because it can get stolen. So we're like, okay, back to the problem that, you know, the concept is good, the people understand what you can do with the app, but they don't use it because they don't want to pay with their phone. They'd rather have some dollar bills in their pocket and pay with dollar bills rather than taking out their phone in regions where it can be stolen. Well, of course, other problems also. Even though we built the Trustlines app as simple to use as possible for people that don't know what crypto is, so abstract the public addresses away, only used plain vanilla names, basically, still very complicated. Another project that we have, Myanmar, after the military coup that they had there, the problem number one is military walk into people's apartments and shoot people because they're using alternative currencies, and therefore they're scared to use alternative currencies. And that's something that we cannot solve as Trustlines. And we can go there and we can say, hey, you can use alternative currency, you don't have to use the local currency, you can use Trustlines to pay, etc. But we can't stand in front of the military and say, well, it's okay for them to use Trustlines. So again, good fit for, you know, out of a third perspective, but if you actually go into the country, really bad concept. Then we had a pilot project in Africa, and we always thought Africa is also a good fit, so Kenya especially. The problem in Kenya is that they really don't understand the concept of money, because all the concepts that they pitched us were like, okay, we could do this. We looked at it and we said, this is a Ponzi scheme, what you're illustrating to us. And they did not mean to, you know, flunk people, but they just did not have the understanding of networks, etc. And they said that for them, this sounds plausible, this is workable. We said, we cannot help you do this because the people on the bottom of the pyramid, they will, you know, lose a lot of money. So again, lack of education there. So that's basically one of the experience that we had overall with Trustlines. And for people that listening and people that are in the room here, that's basically the challenge that I'm giving you with. Yeah? So we have spent a lot of time, a lot of money, a lot of resources trying to find fits for Trustlines, not necessarily in Germany or Europe, because German systems work good, European payment systems also work good, but if you have any ideas or any connections or any networks outside of Europe where you think alternative currency systems are useful, please feel free to approach me. Let me just double check, bootstrapping. So this is the app basically. It's freely downloadable on Apple Store and iOS Store. Very easy to use. Very robust. We're currently migrating to the Gnosis chain, which will probably be done end of November. And we have different currency networks that you can use. And that's basically Trustlines. Questions? No questions means I did a good job.
Ah,
damn, okay.
Two questions. What's the biggest trust lines you have? Can you see that?
I can see it. I also know who it is, but I'm not telling.
All right. Second question. Can you use different tokens, or is it just the trust lines token?
So we deployed more than 30 currency networks, which are smart contracts in itself, that represent real-world currencies. So we did not want to go into the challenge of, you know, for example, circles or other community currencies that create their own currency, and then you have to go into the price finding of what is that token worth, etc. We just said we'll use existing currencies so that they can create trust lines in the existing currencies, but you can also create your own and deploy that also, and then you can have that in the app too.
Hi. So when you first developed it, was the intention for it to be used in, say, the global south, as you described, and not in sort of European or Western societies?
The initial aim was to provide an alternative to traditional finance, but always with the aim to go into countries that have either no financial system, and therefore the people are excluded basically out of, you know, traditional finance, or to go into countries where there is some type of dictatorship pressing on the people, yeah, to basically provide them with an alternative.
Okay, thanks.
Interesting. Thank you so much for your time, Andre. Thank you. Oh, one more question?
One more question?
No?
No?
Do you have one?
One more question?
Okay.
Sorry. What exactly, I mean, obviously this depends on which country you're in, but what exactly are the on-ramps and off-ramps systems, especially for countries where on-ramps in general are very hard to come by for any kind of crypto?
And with on-ramps, you mean like an exchange to...
Right.
So that's the thing. You don't need on- and off-ramps for trust lines. You create your own money. Since it's a mutual credit system, basically... I extend a credit line to you, you extend a credit line to me, and if I pay you, I create the own money. That's why people-powered money. I create IOUs that I issue to you. I don't need any access to crypto. I don't need any access to legacy finance. I create my own money. I replace banks.
Gotcha.
Thank you.